Hello everyone and welcome to a project I've been working on for a while now. Ever since I've rebooted my Thomas universe with my new railway series, I've wanted to create a map to show this island. I decided to do a video on my map after watching the Unlucky Tugs videos. I was originally going to use his map too. I even added the Coldy Fell Mountain Railway to his map. But I then saw that my new universe were going to be different and adding new changes was going to be difficult. So I decided to work from scratch. This video is going to feel like the Unlucky Tugs map video. And I'd be lying if I said he wasn't the inspiration for this video. But you know what they say, imitation is the highest form of flattery. Before we start, here are some things to note. Number 1. This is a map for my new book series. This map won't work for the model series or the CGI series. It might not even be perfect for the railway series universe. Number 2. This map is my own headcanon, not meant to be the actual map of Sodor. Check out the Unlucky Tug for a more accurate map. Number 3. You are going to see some similarities between mine and the Unlucky Tug's map. My excuse for this is, the dude makes so much sense. And with that out of the way, let's start by taking a look at each line on the island. Starting with the main line. The main line runs from Knapford, the town on the west of Sodor, all the way to Fickerstown, the town on the far east of Sodor. The main line is mainly three tracks. The start of the main line is Knapford, the main terminus for the main line and a couple of branch lines too. Like the Unlucky Tug, I've switched the directions. In the railway series, Tidmouth is the start of the main line. But after years of watching Thomas and Friends, I'm used to Knapford by now, and I'm sure most of you guys are too. The express starts its journey from here. Before we go forward, let's talk about Knapford Harbour and the shunting yard. The shunting yard is located just behind the station. All the trains for the mainline engines are arranged here by the Knapford pilot engine. From the 1990s onwards, Sergeant Warrington is the pilot, with D4 Mavis helping out when needed. There's also an engine shed here for the railway's goods engines. Then there's Knapford Harbour. This harbour is the second largest port on the island. Stone from Farquhar Quarry is brought here, and so is fish from the fishing boats. The Flying Kipper starts from this port. As most of us know, the island of Sodor is located between England and the Isle of Man. Further west is Ireland. I like to think that a passenger ferry service runs between Sodor and Ireland, possibly to the Isle of Man too. Knapford Harbour would be perfect for a ferry port, with some passenger trains starting at the port. Next station is Lower Tidmouth, a small passenger station for the town folk on the outskirts of the town. The express doesn't stop here. Then we reach Tidmouth. Tidmouth is a big industrial town and the headquarters of the North Western Railway. The coaling plant and the main engine sheds are here. In this universe, the steam team doesn't sleep in the same shed. Tidmouth sheds are home to Henry, Gordon, James and Bear, with two spare berths for new characters. Sergeant Warrington has his own shed in Knapford shunting yard, and I like to think that Murdoch would rather stay at Knapford shed where there's less engines. More peace and quiet for the big guy. After Tidmouth is the junction for the Little Western branch line. After that is Henry's Tunnel. My theory for the two tunnels is that the single tunnel was originally built for the Knapford and Ellsbridge Light Railway, but when it and the Wellsworth and Sudbury Railway joined together, it was decided to bore a new double tunnel next to it, so the single tunnel didn't need to close during construction. It was called the Ellsbridge Tunnel, but we all know how it got its better well-known name of Henry's Tunnel.
No one ever lets me forget the time I wouldn't come out of the tunnel in case the rain spoilt my paint, huffed Henry.
Next is Ellsbridge Station. This is the junction station for Thomas's branch line and the loop line. More on them later. the express doesn't stop here. Between Ellsbridge and Crosby is the first of many bridges on the main line. Bluebell Bridge is a three-track iron bridge, which got its name from the time Bluebell the cow stopped Gordon and Henry on the bridge. Next up is Crosby Station, a small town station with a small shunting yard. This is the station where Duck crashed into the barber shop. The express doesn't stop here. Then comes the second bridge on the main line, the viaduct. This is the only part of the main line that is two tracks. My theory for this is that the viaduct was built to join the Knapford and Ellsbridge Light Railway and the Wellsworth and Sudbury Railway together. At the time of build, the tracks between them was just going to be two tracks, and it wasn't until all the standard gauge railways on Sodor joined together that it was decided to make the main line three tracks. But by then the viaduct was complete. I'm not an engineer or an architect, but I imagine that widening a stone viaduct that big is very difficult and very expensive, which is why the viaduct is still two tracks to this day. Then we reach Wellsworth Station, or as it's nicknamed, Edwards Station. This is the start of Edwards Branch Line to Brendon. It has its own shunting yard and engine shed for Edward, Boko and Emily to sleep in. More on this line later. In my universe, the express does stop here to pick up passengers from Brendon. It and other heavy trains also wait here for a banking engine to help them with Gordon's Hill. Speaking of which, next is Gordon's Hill, the steepest part of the main line. The hill got its name when Gordon got stuck on it and had to be rescued by Edward. The hill's steep ascent is only on the west side, and the eastern side falls more gradually with a couple of bends. Next is Marrone Station, another small town with a few sidings. It also has a runaway siding ending in a bank of earth. This is the station Thomas's first runaway ended at, and where James crashed into some tar wagons. The express doesn't stop here. Next up is Kildane and Cronk. Kildane is the second largest city on Sodor. It became so big that the outskirts of the city reached the smaller town of Cronk. Cronk station is small and used only for local passenger trains. The express doesn't stop here, but it does stop at Kildane. Kildane has a large canopy station with three platforms, two either side of the three mainline tracks, and one on the north side for the Peel Godred branch line. More on that line later. Just after Kildane is Henry's Forest. In the model series, Henry's Forest is shown to be located between Wellsworth and the viaduct, but that looks too cramped to me. I wanted my Henry's Forest to be big, so I placed it just after Kildane. I like the idea of one of Sodor's most populated areas and largest woodland area are next to each other. Poetic if you ask me. In Henry's Forest is Balladryn. In my headcanon, Balladryn was a logging town for loggers and workers of the old Sodor Logging Company. Logging was a huge industry back in the early 1900s, but nowadays it's just a small woodland town. The express doesn't stop here. Next is Kelsthorpe Road, another small town station with multiple platforms. It's also the junction station for the Kirk Roaring branch line. More on that later. I'm going to say that the express doesn't stop here, because there doesn't seem to be a reason for it to at the moment. But I am open to maybe it being added to the express route in the future. After Kelsthorpe Road is another big station, Crovan's Gate. This station is famous for being the junction station with the Scarlowy Railway. It is also the location of the engine workshops, known as the Works. I decided not to use the steamworks or the diesel works in my universe, and I like to think that the works building was the sheds for the old Sodor and Mainland Railway. The works has expanded to repair and service all the island's steam engines, and getting in the equipment to repair diesel engines too. The two engines that work here are the works diesel, which I've called Basil, because the Class 47s were named Brush. See what I did there? The other engine is Harvey the Crane engine. I do have plans to write a book introducing these two and their friendships. So wait and see. Sorry to all you Victor and Kevin fans. But I can't be the only one bothered by the fact that the works would use a narrow gauge engine to shunt in the workshop. That's mostly deals with the standard gauge engines. Basil and Harvey make so much more sense to me. After Croven's Gate is the third bridge on the main line. I've decided to place the suspension bridge here. I love this bridge. After that is a tunnel. On Audrey's map, this would have been Henry's tunnel. But in my universe, Henry's tunnel's on the west side of Sodor. So I've called it Vickerstown Tunnel. Then we have Vickerstown Station, a large terminus station with 5 platforms. 2 for the North Western Railway, 1 for the Northern B branch line, and 2 for the other railway. An engine yard and a small shunting yard was here, but since the 1950s they have been demolished and ripped up. For many years this was the last stop on the main line, until Sir Tobham Hat II made a deal with the LMS to run trains into England. The main line now crosses the rolling bridge called Vickerstown Bridge, over the Wrongly Channel, and now terminates at Barrow-in-Furness. In my universe, this station is a 3 platform station for both Sodor and the other railway. There's a goods yard here for trains from Sodor to connect to other goods trains to travel further into England and for goods into Sodor. I like to think that the Fat Controller made a deal with the other railway where he supplied the pilot engine for this yard. But because of the other railway not using steam anymore, he had to get a diesel shunter. Good thing that Sodor has no shortage of diesel shunters. And that's the full main line. Now let's cover the branch lines on the island, starting with the most famous branch line of them all, Thomas's branch line. In my universe, Thomas's branch line starts at Knapford from platform 3 and is run by 5 engines. Thomas and Lady run the passenger services, while Percy, Toby and Mavis handle the goods work. Just like in the railway series, the tracks of Thomas's branch line are the old Knapford and Ellsbridge light railway tracks. The line goes right here, past the bus garage where Bertie the bus lives. The first stop on Thomas's line is Dryor, a small countryside town with an airfield next to the station. This is where Harold the helicopter lives. Next is a goods station called Toywick. Thomas only picks up passengers from here at peak times. The goods line heads towards the Old Harbour. The Old Harbour was used by the K&E Light Railway and the early years of the NWR, until the larger dock was built at Knapford. It was rebuilt in the 1950s and now exports small cargo boats and stone from Farquhar Quarry. Only goods engines like Percy and Mavis goes down there. After Toywick is Ellsbridge Station, the junction station for Thomas's line. The tracks in between Ellsbridge and Knapford via Dryor are 2 tracks and used to be the old loop line of the main line.
I was switched off the main line onto the loop. I had to go all round and back again.
Today only Thomas's passenger trains go down these tracks, and it's a very rare sight to see the main line engines on it. Just after the station and the town is the stone bridge crossing the River Ells, and then the tracks become single track. The middle station on Thomas's line is Maythwaite. Did you know that Maythwaite isn't a creation of Wilbur Audrey? It's made its first appearance in the season 5 episode Bar, where the station won the best station competition. Some believe that Maythwaite is a misspelling of Marthwaite, and was originally intended to be a station on Toby's branch line. As it's the middle station, my version of Maythwaite has a passing loop in it. After that comes Hackingback Tunnel. On the north side of the tunnel is Kindly's Cottage, where Mr. and Mrs. Kindly live. It is also here where Mrs. Kindly saved Thomas from crashing into a landslide. Not far away is Hackingback Station, a small single platform station with a passing loop. Hackenbeck is a small hamlet with its own brewery. Hackenbeck beer is a popular drink on Sodor. Then we have Farquhar Station. Farquhar used to be the last stop on Thomas's line. Here are the sheds for the line's engines. It used to be a single brick shed built for Thomas, but he has expanded twice over the years. First to turn it into a three engine shed with stone, and then in the 70s to be a four engine shed. Thomas, Percy, Toby and Lady live here. There's also a carriage shed here for Annie, Clarabelle and Henrietta, and a small shunting yard. It was in this yard that Thomas crashed into the station master's house. The tracks continue here and go two ways. First is the goods line to the Farquhar Quarry. Because the land was too tight for both rail and road, a tramway track was decided on. Thomas was in trouble with a policeman on this line because of his uncovered wheels.
"Where's your cow catcher?" he asked. "But I don't catch cows, sir." "Don't be funny," snapped the policeman.
It was because of this that Toby was brought to the line and why Mavis was fitted with side plates. The law is out of date and Thomas and Percy are allowed to go to the quarry. In my book, Salty the Dockside Diesel, Mavis worked at the quarry until a new manager wanted to replace and scrap her. But she was saved by the fat controller and she became the pilot engine for Knapford and helps on Thomas's branch line with goods work. I was thinking of making Fergus the traction engine the new shunter at the quarry. What do you think? In the 1970s, the old line to Alstead was discovered, and since then, they have been restored, making Alstead the terminus of Thomas's branch line. In between the two stations is Alstead Castle. Unlike the CGI series, Alstead Castle is a ruin and a popular spot for tourists. I like to think that passenger trains only stop here in the summertime or for special events. The town of Alstead was abandoned for some time, but today it has been restored and to be a miner's town for the workers working in Farquhar Quarry. And that is Thomas's branch line. Next up is a far simpler yet very important branch line, Edward's branch line. The tracks of the Brendon branch are the old tracks of the Wellsworth and Sudbury Railway. Edward is the engine in charge of this line and works here with Boko and Emily. This is also the only branch line on Sodor that's two tracks for its entire length. For a branch line, there's quite a few important locations here. The branch line starts at Wellsworth Station and then trains pass through a junction just before Gordon's Hill. The first stop on the line is Sudbury. Did you know that Sudbury is the capital city on Sodor? It's never made sense to me that an important city like that would be on a branch line and not the main line. I like to think that Kronk and Kildane are Sodor's capital, and Sudbury is the third most populated place on the island. The tracks then lead to Brendon. Upper Brendon is a passenger station for the people of Brendon town. And the last station on the line is Brendon Docks, the largest harbour and dockyard on Sodor. Salty the Dockyard Diesel works here, and so does two cranes, Cranky the Crane and Big Mickey from America. That's why, folks, tugs exist in my universe. Brendon Docks is also a large export of China clay. A single goods track was laid between Brendon Docks and the China Clay Works, and this line is run by the SCC's private saddle tank engines, Bill and Ben. That's Edward's branch line, and now let's go back to the west of Sodor and talk about Duck's branch line, aka the Little Western. The Little Western is a coastal track that runs between Tidmouth and Callum. Duck was given this line for his hard work and his friendship with the Oldsdale engines. After Oliver came to the line, it became known as the Little Western. Duck and Oliver handled the passenger trains with their auto coaches. while Donald and Douglas pulled the ballast and goods trains. The passenger services start at Netford from platform 4. Then they go through Lower Tidmouth and stop at Tidmouth Station. The trains then take the left track and go through a tunnel, which I've called Tidmouth Tunnel. The first stop on the Little Western is Tidmouth Hold. This is where Tidmouth Bay is, a beautiful sandy beach with a pier and a small seaside village. Next is the middle station of Holtra, a seaside town next to Tidmouth Bay. The station here has a small island platform and a passing loop for Duck and Oliver. Next is Oldsborough Station. Oldsborough used to be a big port for the Mid-Sodor Railway, but the port closed down when the Mid-Sodor did. Nowadays it's a marina for sailing boats. I like to think that there is a maritime museum here and maybe a museum for the old Mid-Sodor Railway too. The station is next door to a shunting yard for ballast and the headquarters of the Oldsdale Railway. More on these little guys later. The terminus station on this line is Callan Station. The carriage shed for the line coaches are here, as well as the engine shed for Duck, Donald, Douglas and Oliver to sleep. Over the years, two extensions were built. The first tracks are built to Callan Castle in Misty Valley. Unlike Alstead Castle, Callan Castle is a restored estate where Lord Callan lives. Duck and Oliver only stop at the castle when it is open to the public. The other extension is a new branch line to Hartwick. So while we're here, let's talk about Arthur's branch line. Before we start, I'd just like to say that my next book is Arthur the LMS Engine, which will be an origin story for Arthur and the Hartwick book line. I don't want to give away any story plots from that book, but I will explain the line, its stations, and a brief look at the engines on the line. The tracks to Hartwick were built in the late 1960s, when the fishermen of Hartwick asked for a line to help in transporting their fish. Hartwick is the largest and busiest fishing village on Sodor, so the Fat Controller agreed and a single track branch line was built from Callan to Hartwick. Arthur was brought on to help build the line and later was given the line to run. In the 1970s, Iwis became to the branch line to run the passenger service between Callan and Hartwick. You can learn more about Iwis in my book, Legend of the Half Engine. Just after Callan, the line goes through a tunnel to Bluffs Cove, another sandy beach on the west of Sodor. In summer, this station becomes very busy with the holidaymakers and tourists. Next up is Village Station. In the Unlucky Tugs map video, he has this station as Seaside Village. I want to give this place a name, and I think I have one. Just east of the village is Clark O'Hire Mountain. So I've called the Seaside Village Clark Village. Have I just beaten the Unlucky Tug to something? In my universe, this is the village where the Seaside Festival takes place in Toby's Seaside Holiday, the story that was adapted into the season 4 episode Special Attraction. The last stop in line is Hartwick. The station is on the quay next to the sea. Iris's passenger trains terminates here. Arthur collects fish from here and takes it down the line, through the Little Western and all the way to Knapford Harbour, where his train joins the Flying Kipper. There's an engine shed here for Arthur and Iris. Arthur's branch line is one of the smallest lines on the island. So let's now talk about one of the biggest branch lines, the Peel Godred line. The Peel Godred branch line is the only electrified line on the island. It was built to help move heavy equipment to Peel Godred. The equipment was for the power station where they built a hydroelectric dam. The power station supplies the electricity for the branch line. This branch line will be explained in the book, The Peel Godred Mystery. Not much is known about the engines on this line, so I've made two characters for this line. The first one is 13, the electric engine. He is based on an LNER Class EE1 and is nicknamed Jinx. The second one is a new character I'm creating, possibly based on a BR Class 310. Suggestions are welcome in the comments below. The branch line starts at Kildane Station, where we meet connecting trains with the main line. There are also connecting tracks from Kronk for trains from the west side of Sodor. The first stop on the line is Kronk Abbey Station, a small country village with a monastery and a public school. Only a limited passenger train stops here in peak time. Next is Kirkmacchan, a small village at the very foot of Caldy Vale Mountain, and the junction station for the Caldy Vale Mountain Railway. More on that later. The last station on the line is Peel Godwin, a large walled fortress town that was built on a hill. The station is raised above the town. Peel Godwin is the location of the power station, the hydroelectric dam, and the Sodor Ironworks, a large metal foundry where scrap metal is delivered, melted down, and repurposed. The ironworks is run by two BR Class 08 diesels called Ari and Bert. Now we only have two standard gauge branch lines left. Let's start with the Kirk Warren branch line. Now I know what some of you have already been thinking. Hey James, you've missed out an engine on the Farquhar branch, Daisy the diesel rail car. Well, I haven't. In my headcanon, the Kirk Warren branch line was part of the Sodor and Mainland Railway, but this part of the line closed down when the main line was built. The tracks to Kirk Warren were restored in the early 1960s. The line has no industries on it, so this branch line is run just for passengers. This is the perfect place for Daisy to work. She was assigned the branch line and travels up and down the line, making Daisy the first diesel on the island to be given a branch line. The branch line only has three stations and starts at Kelsfort Road from platform 3. The middle station is Rolf's Castle, a small town with a castle on the outskirts. The castle is used for tourists and events. In my universe, the castle is also used for the New Year's Day fireworks display. The branch line ends at Kirk Warren, a port town that used to serve the Sodor and Mainland Railway. It was at this port that Skar Lorry arrived on Sodor. In the fifth series of the show, Kirk Warren is a large terminus station with 8 platforms. It's also the location of an ambitious crash. To me, that's a bit overkill. So it's just a 2-platform terminus station with a roof canopy, with a wall with a panoramic view for the town and sea. As for the time of this video, only Daisy works on this line. Maybe in the future more engines may be needed. Now it's time for the last standard gauge branch line on Sodor, the Normanby branch line. The Normanby branch line is made by the old tracks from the Sodor and Mainland Railway. They made the tracks between Crovens Gate and Ballyhoo and had plans to continue towards Vicarstown. But the S&M went bankrupt. When the North Western Railway was born in the 1910s, they finished the tracks to Vicarstown, meaning this part of the branch line was their main line. But as trains got heavier, a new main line was built and created a new direct route to Vicarstown. The tracks were then added from Ballyhoo to the seaside town of Normanby. Sir Tom had even made a deal with the LMS on England, which allowed LMS services to Normanby in exchange to allowing Sodor trains to go to Barrow. For many years, this line was operated by the LMS and then by British Rail. This branch line was part of the Beeching Act in the 1960s, but thankfully Sir Tom had stepped in and this line is run by the NWR. At the moment, the mainline engines run the line with a limited service to Normanby, except in summertime when the line gets more visitors. Who do you think should run the line full time? And that's all the standard gauge railways on Sodor. Now we can look at the narrow gauge, starting with the oldest surviving railway on the island, the Skarloey Railway. In my universe, the Skarloey Railway was built in 1863, with tracks laid between Skarloey to Cloven's Gate. This railway was built to replace a horse-drawn railroad built from a copper mine to the port of Ballywell. Since the Skarloey was built, the tracks to Ballywell were ripped up and the port has been closed to this day. The line also has the oldest working steam engine on Sodor, with Skarloey, who arrived on Sodor in 1865, and still works today. Today, the line is used for passengers and to serve the slate quarry at the top of the line. The trains start at Cloven's Gate, where a platform for the narrow gauge railway is located next to the main line platform. The sheds for the narrow gauge engines are here, and so is the shunting yard. There's also a transfer yard where the slate from the quarry is transferred from the narrow gauge trains into the mainline goods trains. After Cloven's Gate are two stations, Crossley Cairn, followed by Glenock. These two stations are for the countryside villages on the route. At the top of the line is a loop that circles a lake. There are three stations here, Skarloey, Reneas and Lakeside, all with towns and very popular with tourists. Lakeside is right on the edge of the lake and has a harbour for the sailing boat and many businesses for visitors. Just outside Skarloey station are the points towards the slate mine. The tracks go up a ravine to the mine and there are disused tracks here for Boulder Quarry, named after the old boulder that used to stand on the cliff overlooking the quarry. But when the boulder fell and destroyed the yard, the quarry was closed down. See my book, Ivor Hugh, The Young Engine, for more information on that. While we're on this part of Sodor, let's look at another railway in the Sodor Hills, the one going straight up Caldy Fell Mountain. The Caldy Fell Mountain Railway has only appeared in one book of the railway series, but it has become a fan favourite. Based on the Snowdon Mountain Railway in Wales, this railway is run by 8 narrow gauge engines using rack and pinion to climb the mountain tracks. The line starts at Kirkmatchan on the Peel Godric branch line, crossing a bridge over the branch line and stops at the first stop on the line, Shiloh. Next is Skarloey Road and then Devil's Back. This is the station where Lord Harry rescued climbers in a storm. The line ends at Caldy Fell Summit. Next up, let's talk about another small railway on the island, the Oldsdale Light Railway. The Oldsdale Light Railway was built on the old track bed of the closed Mid-Sodor Railway. This line is based on the Ravenglass and Exdale Railway in England, which is a 15-inch gauge railway, making this railway the smallest gauge railway on Sodor. At the time of this video, there were only 5 engines on this railway: Bert, Rex, Mike, Frank and Jock. The railway starts at Aldsworth, where it connects with the Little Western. It's here where the engine sheds and the hopper for the ballast trucks are. Next is Lower Aldsworth, and then the small country village of Marthwaite. This is the location where Rex crashed into some hay bales. Then we have Oldsdale and the line terminus, Oldsdale End. Oldsdale is a small village based in the valley. Oldsdale has a turntable at the end of the platform so trains can turn around their coaches for the return. And while we're talking about the Oldsdale Railway, let's talk quickly about the closed railway of the Mid-Sodor. The Mid-Sodor was a narrow gauge railway from 1880 to 1947. It was built to serve a quarry in the northwest of Sodor, but later it was open for passenger services. Duke was the first engine to run the line, followed by Stanley, Fearless Freddy, Falcon and Stuart. The Mid-Sodor stops at the same stations as the Oldsdale Railway, starting at Oldsborough. Oldsborough was a harbour station, where trucks from the quarry were brought to be unloaded into ships. A ferry service used to run between Oldsborough and the Isle of Man. This is the boat that's mentioned in You Can't Win.
Falcon took Duke's passengers to the boat.
After Oldsdale End, the line continued through the mountains. This is the section of the line they used to call the Mountain Road. It's also here where Duke saved Falcon from falling over the edge in Bulldog. The line then terminates at Scarlowy Station. This section of the line is still closed to this day. Now we've come to the last railway on this map, a fan-made creation of mine. It's time for the Ballyswain Monorail. I wanted to add something to this map that's never been done before. A new railway using a gauge of track that hasn't been seen before. But which? Sodor already has standard, narrow and minimal, as well as whack and pinion railways and a funicular railway. The only gauge left is broad gauge, but that to me is a bit overkill. Then while doing research on historical railways, a big light bulb moment came to me. A monorail.
Well, sir, there's nothing on earth like a genuine, bona fide, electrified six-car monorail. What'd I say?
Monorail.
What's it called?
Monorail.
That's right, monorail.
But thankfully, Sodor didn't get its monorail from Lyle Langley. This railway is based on the Lartigue monorail, built in Ireland in 1888. The monorail was designed by a French engineer called Charles Lartigue, who designed it for building railways in the desert. This was also cheap to build, and the Leasthow and Ballybunion Railway became the first monorail in the world to be used in official passenger service. Three locomotives were built to run this line, and they were 030s, with two boilers and two fireboxes for perfect balance. It was closed in 1924, after the Irish Civil War damaged the tracks and rolling stock. In real life, all the engines, rolling stock and most of the track was scrapped. In 2003, a 1 kilometer section of the monorail track was built and a museum for the old railway was opened. A diesel-powered replica of the engines was built for demonstrations. In my universe, things went differently. Most of it was saved by Sir Robert Charles Normanby, the father of Sir Robert Normanby. Like his son, he had a great love of railways and found the monorail in Ireland fascinating. So he bought one of the engines along with some track and three of the carriages and had them shipped to his estate on Sodor. He planned to build the monorail around his estate for visitors, but he was killed during World War II and the monorail was kept in storage for years. But in the 1980s, the engine and monorail was discovered by Sir Robert Normanby, who decided to have the engine restored. I decided the best place to build the monorail was in the north of Sodor, on the horse-drawn railway that served the closed Craigweir mine. But why would they need a monorail? Well, here's my idea. In 1981, it was decided to increase the tourist trade on Sodor. Remember that the TV show didn't start until 1984, so the island of Sodor wasn't as well known back in those days. So plans were made to build a theme park on the island. They decided to use the open land northeast of Sodor on the coast. They even met with the Fat Controller to build a branch line to the park, and he decided to use this line to connect with the last two villages on the island by rail. And thankfully, the Earl of Sodor had just found a railway.
And I swear it's Springfield's only choice. Throw up your hands and raise your voice.
Monorail.
What's it called?
Monorail.
Once again.
Monorail.
They called the line the Ballyswain Monorail. They thought that using the monorail would draw in the reporters, So basically, it was a publicity stunt to draw people to the theme park. But the monorail proved to be very successful and was treated like a proper railway on the island. To solve many of the problems the Irish monorail had, Sir Tom had decided to make the monorail a loop line to avoid using points and turntables, and using bridges for roads and footbridges to avoid using level crossings. The monorail starts at Harwich, where it picks up passengers from Iris's trains, then goes to Craigmere, then stops at Sodor's theme park when the park is opened. When it's closed for winter, the trains go straight through, and then stops at the coastal village of Ballyswain. Then it goes back to Harwich to start the circle again. For the engine, I've created a new OC called Annabella, the Monorail Sisters. They're based on the original engine that ran the Irish Monorail, making them the only 030 engine on Sodor. They are conjoined twins, similar to Mighty Mac. Anna has a bubbly and funny personality, while Bella is more serious and cleverer. They are like a double act, with Anna telling jokes and Bella being the straight man. As for their paintwork, I've taken inspiration from Harley Quinn costumes, which have bright colours and asymmetrical design. Everyone on the line loves Annabella and their jokes. And that's everything about the Ballyswain monorail. So let's finish by listening to that song again.
Mono, don't!
And that's everything on my map so far. It's far from finished, as I do want to add roads and rivers to the map, along with more details. I'm also open to any ideas or thoughts that you have about my map. If you see any mistakes that I've missed, do feel free to tell me. Before we finish, I just wanted to give a couple shoutouts. First to Train Inspector 11G2 for giving me the original map background to help me create mine. And the second to Danielle Thomas for becoming my first ever Patreon supporter. If you'd like to support my channel and help in creating more videos, a link is in the description below. Time to end. Thank you very much for watching. Good night.